This week on Wealth Track, third-generation value investor Chris Davis inherited an appreciation for the value of financial stocks from his grandfather and father. What's the outlook for the battered sector now? The Davis Fund's Chris Davis is next on Consuelo Mack Wealth Track.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sayles, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Thornburg Investment Management, active management, global perspective. Rosalind P. Walter and the Fairholme Foundation.
Hello and welcome to this edition of Wealth Track. I'm Consuelo Mack. Bankers, financiers, or money lenders, as they have been called derisively at various points in history, are currently at one of their reputational low points. Presidential candidates from Bernie Sanders to Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump have all taken their shots. Sanders has introduced the Too Big to Fail, Too Big to Exist Act, which would break up the big banks. This is not a modern phenomenon. Thomas Jefferson once stated, "I believe that banking institutions are more dangerous to our liberties than standing armies." You can see why he and Alexander Hamilton, who created the first national bank and was the first Treasury Secretary, had their disagreements. Even some titans of industry have been critics. Henry Ford, the founder of the Ford Motor Company, was one of them, stating, "It is well enough that people of the nation do not understand our banking and money system, for if they did, I believe there would be a revolution before tomorrow morning." Luckily, that revolution never came. Well, for the record, banking and Wall Street provide the essential fuel for economic growth, money and credit. They enable individuals, companies, and governments to raise capital, buy goods and services, build, expand, and invest. Investing in financial stocks in recent years, however, has been challenging. Over the last decade, the S&P 500 Financials Index has delivered negative annualized returns, whereas the S&P 500 has not. And although their annualized performance over the last 5 and 3 year periods has been close to 10%, the group has continued to underperform the market. This week's guest is a third generation value investor whose family has a long history of investing in financial stocks and continues to do so today. He is Christopher Davis, Chairman of Davis Advisors, Portfolio Manager of the Davis Large Cap Portfolios, Co-Portfolio Manager since 1995 of the firm's flagship Davis New York Venture Fund, which was founded by his dad in 1969. Chris has also been the Portfolio Manager of the fund's no-load equivalent, Selected American Shares, since its launch in 2004. He also created the Davis Financial Fund 25 years ago in 1991. Rated 4-star by Morningstar, the fund has far outperformed its benchmark and the market since inception with better than 11% annualized returns. I started the interview by asking Chris why he created a fund focused on financial stocks in the first place.
Well, it was 1991, and I had been a bank and insurance analyst at the firm before I joined the family firm. And I looked out at this world and I thought the first thing about financial stocks that my grandfather taught me is they can be compounding machines. If you get a company with the right culture and the right business, they can really be what he called a growth stock in disguise. They can grow for decades and decades and decades. In fact, 4 of our largest holdings are in their second century as growth machines.
And they are
Wells Fargo's, American Express, Bank of New York, and J.P. Morgan. So these have long decades of growth. So I love what I would call the secular opportunity in financial stocks. But then in 1991, there was a cyclical opportunity too. All investors remembered the financial crisis, but then it was called the S&L crisis.
Right.
Of course, they remembered the collapse of Bank of New England, all the hearings, people had lost faith in the S&L sector, all the banks were down on their luck. Nobody wanted to go near them. And so I saw a cyclical opportunity to buy these companies when they were out of favor in a sector in which everybody in the country is a customer.
So what I'm trying to figure out, though, is if you have a sector fund, you have to invest in that sector, no matter what's going on cyclically. I mean, you know, how has it been kind of stuck with having to invest in the financial sector?
Well, unlike energy, financials is a vast sector.
Right.
It includes everything from automobile insurers like Progressive to companies like Berkshire Hathaway to banks like Julius Baer in Switzerland or JP Morgan here. So it's a vast sector. And as I say, within that sector, there are these companies that have compounded for not just years, but for decades, in some cases for generations. But just like you say, there's also these cyclical opportunities. And here we are with the financial crisis so fresh in people's minds. I think people believe that they just don't want to look at them. They're being regulated out of business. They're like utilities. They're high risk, and people don't want to look at them. So they're at some of their lowest relative valuations, and in many cases, in decades. So you've got an opportunity when people don't like them, but they've already gone through their crisis.
Right.
So in a sense, that's the best combination. A low valuation, they're much safer than they've been in decades, with much higher capital ratios, much better earnings power, a lot of excess capital being generated. It's a cyclical and a secular opportunity now.
The risk, though, it seems to me, I mean, we're going through a wave of populism that is very anti-bank. There could be more regulations. There could be some people who are going to want to, you know, shut down some of the major institutions like a Wells Fargo or a JP Morgan Chase. Is this time different?
Well, what I loved about your introduction is you made it clear that hating banks has been a sort of a mantra for hundreds of years.
Right.
You know, from the time Alexander Hamilton started the Bank of New York, there's been factions of the population that have hated the banks, and yet here they are, they're all customers of the banks. Now, you're right, we could be in an environment where there continues to be regulatory pressure to split them up. I don't think it's certain that they would be worth less split up. I don't think it's certain that they would be less, they would earn less money if they were split up. What's happened, of course, is the barriers to entry are getting higher and higher and higher because of this regulatory pressure. So I think banking, the product is here to stay. The institutions are here to stay. The hostile political climate towards banking is nothing new, and yet they've already doubled their capital ratios. They're in a much safer place than they are, so they'll be able to withstand this wave, and so I don't think this time is different.
And Chris, how do you handle the down cycles? I mean, have you basically stayed with these, you know, companies like a Wells Fargo, for instance, and a JP Morgan Chase, you know, through the times when they were, you know, they were just being pummeled?
Well, of course, as usual, Warren Buffett said it best. He said, you know, it's when the tide goes out, you see who's swimming without a bathing suit.
Right.
When we went through the financial crisis, all the bank stocks went down.
Yes.
But, you know, it's amazing to think, you know, companies like JP Morgan never lost money in the financial crisis. They've never had, they did not lose money for any year during that period. Wells Fargo did not lose money during the financial crisis. So the stocks went down, but of course, did the businesses get a lot less valuable? No. In fact, I would argue they got more valuable because both JP Morgan and Wells took advantage, to quote Winston Churchill, they didn't let a good crisis go to waste. They took advantage of the crisis. They did large acquisitions with the support of the government, who recognized that they were pillars of strength. They came out with higher market share, more earnings power than they had before they went in. So yes, the stocks were risky in the sense that they were volatile, they gyrated around, but the businesses were sound. And in the end of the day, it was the value of the business that carried us through that period. So yes, we owned those institutions through that, and of course, they have record profits today, and they never lost money, even in the crisis.
Right. I mentioned in my introduction to you as well that the financial fund has outperformed both the broader market, the S&P 500, but also the index. And of course, we are seeing a large move among investors, flows into index funds and out of actively managed funds. But why do you think it's dangerous? Why do you think it could be a problem for individual investors to go passive?
Well, I'll start by talking about the financial sector
Yes.
as an index, because there it would seem obvious. You know, what happens in the financial sector is automatically, if you buy a financial ETF, the most money goes into the biggest financial, the next money into the next biggest financial, and so on.
Right, they're capitalization weighted, right.
Exactly,
right.
And there is no correlation with quality. Right before the financial crisis, Bank of America and Wells Fargo were roughly the same businesses, they were roughly the same size. What happened? One went down 90% and one's at an all-time high. Right? Well, think about JP Morgan and Citibank. They were in the same businesses, they were roughly the same size, roughly the same geographies. One went down 80 or 90%, the other is at an all-time high. So the in terms of its profits.
Right, right.
So
right.
The inability to discriminate, I think, makes a financial index very dangerous. Because within financial stocks, there's leverage and you want to really focus on quality. So when we started the fund, we said, we expect to beat any financial index, but we also want to own financials because we think the best financials will beat the average company. So we wanted to beat the S&P as well as the financial sector fund. And that's what we've done over those 25 years.
And why is that?
What we're looking for is an above average business at a below average price. You put those together and you'll get an above average return. And so banks and financials are a great place to look because the natural assumption people have is that they must be below average businesses. They don't imagine that Wells Fargo has had a 14 or 15% return on equity for 40 years. They just think, oh, it must be a cyclical, volatile business. It couldn't be a growth company. And therefore, the shares trade at 12 times earnings instead of a market multiple at 16 or 17 times earnings. So you get a better business at a below average price.
Explain another disconnect for me. Warren Buffett, you recently went to the Berkshire Hathaway annual meeting. You own a longtime owner of Berkshire Hathaway stock. Yet Warren Buffett and Charlie Munger get up there, Warren Buffett especially, and basically they criticize Wall Street. They, with reason, there's some valid criticisms of Wall Street, but specifically of active management. And they say that the vast majority of individuals are better off owning an S&P 500 index fund than they are in going with an active manager. Explain, what is your response to Warren Buffett saying that, who is himself an active manager?
Well, I think the first point I would say is that the average active manager has a lot of explaining to do.
Right.
Right? The average active manager, forget the fact that they charge high fees, they also have high turnover. Often they own their stocks for less than a year. They often have portfolio managers that have only been in the job for a few years. Most importantly, the average fund is run by a manager that doesn't have any money invested right. alongside their shareholders. In fact, I think Morningstar reported only 12% of all mutual funds are run by somebody that has more than $1 million invested alongside their clients.
Right. So obviously in the Davis funds, the Davis family does, and you all, as all of your money managers do have money. You've got skin in the game. You're investing alongside your shareholders.
Yes, and right. I think if you said, well, instead of the average active manager, I want to look at a universe of managers that are invested alongside their clients, have long tenure, long experience, have long holding periods, and have below average fees. I mean, we check all those boxes. I think you're going to come out with a very different result than the average managers. So in a sense, I can accept Warren's criticism about the industry, and I wouldn't make a case to defend the industry in general. But I think that just as Warren wrote in his famous essay, The Super Investors of Graham and Doddsville, mm-hmm. he said, there is a universe of people that have succeeded in outperforming the index for a long period of time. And I don't see why that should change over the next 20 years versus the last 20.
What is your view of Berkshire Hathaway right now?
Well, we have a large investment in
yes.
Berkshire Hathaway.
And have for
I think
years,
it
right?
is an absolutely wonderful investment right now. It's trading at about 1.4 times book value, and Warren has said in the annual reports they would be aggressive buyers at 1.2 times book value because they would view it as significantly undervalued. Well, we know that is a conservative culture.
Right.
We know when they use a word like significantly undervalued, that we think that
it's meaningful.
It's meaningful. And there is a wonderful collection. In fact, I would bet quite a large sum of money that Berkshire will outperform the index over a long period of time. And so therefore, you know, the idea that it would be impossible to identify managers that should outperform over time, it doesn't even pass that test. I think Berkshire has above average qualities of businesses. I think it has a wonderful and durable culture, and yet it trades at a below average valuation. In fact, as we look at earnings at Berkshire and we make adjustments for the stock portfolio and so on, we would say Berkshire is trading at about 14 times earnings. So a discount to the market for that management, that quality of business, it's just, that's a wonderful combination. And certainly a stock I think is people could be comfortable having a very meaningful investment in.
Let me ask you about some of the companies that Berkshire Hathaway owns that you own as well. And for instance, the overlap that you have at some of the Davis funds are American Express, which you just mentioned, Bank of New York Mellon, Costco, Wells Fargo, which you just mentioned. Why are, do you own those separately when you have such a large position in Berkshire Hathaway? Why not just own Berkshire Hathaway and let them be the proxy for those companies as well?
Well, I take as my inspiration Mae West. She said, too much of a good thing is wonderful. And I don't think, you know, in some cases there were investments that we owned before Berkshire. In some cases, we've owned them afterwards. When we look at our risk tolerance, we count in our pro rata ownership of the Berkshire shares.
I see. So,
in other words, when we think about how much Wells Fargo we own, we think of our direct investment, but we also think of the risk of the shares that we own through Berkshire. So we don't double, you know, we don't double count it, or we don't omit it from. But on the other hand, we think, of course, well, who would you rather own companies with than have a co-investment along with the investment made by Berkshire Hathaway? I think in many ways we see a lot of the defining characteristics of those businesses the same way.
It's interesting, when I think of the Davis funds, I think of you as being value investors, and I remember Berkshire Hathaway or Warren Buffett saying that he would never, you know, wouldn't own a technology company because he doesn't understand it. Yet in the Davis funds, you own Alphabet, which is Google, and you also own Amazon. So explain, you know, why your view of technology is different from Warren Buffett's and what you see in those two companies.
Well, I think the first point I'd make is that when we study a company like Google or Amazon, we don't use different math, all right? We don't somehow have a different, you know, value it on eyeballs or pops or something like that. You know, we are value investors, which means we use a value discipline. However, one obvious statement is that companies that grow profitably are more valuable than companies that don't. And I think value investors have a terrible time valuing the power of growth. And of course, Warren has been a genius in this way because he recognized that companies like Geico were way more valuable than companies like, you know, the
Nifty 50 or something,
yeah,
or whatever.
Or Allstate, in a sense, Geico was a growth company. And so the growth was a component of how much Geico was worth, its ability to grow. On the other hand, growth investors often make a mistake of not being sensitive enough to valuation. They have sort of growth at any price. You know, so long as it's growing, it must be a buy. That's a very dangerous approach. Over our whole history, since the 1960s when we started New York Venture Fund, we've tried to hold both of those concepts in balance. So we've owned companies like Cap Cities that always looked optically very expensive. Now, in their case, they had lots of amortization that made the earnings look lower than the owner earnings were.
And Berkshire owned Cap Cities.
Owned Cap Cities. Also cable companies, cellular companies. These are companies that were very difficult for typical value investors to own for some time because they didn't see the gap earnings. Well, we've always had this concept of owner earnings. It's looking through the accounting treatment and looking at if you owned the real business, how much cash does it produce today? How much cash should it produce next year, the year after, the year after that? And of course, we value that stream of cash flow. So a company that has a growing cash flow stream could be more valuable, a better value, than a company that looks optically cheap now, but that cash flow is going down. And for Amazon and Google, we use exactly that math. We value Amazon today the way we might have valued Walmart in 1985. We look at the cash that it produces and how much they have to spend to grow. Because remember, Walmart, when it was growing, generated almost no free cash flow, mm-hmm. right? They had to open new stores and buy up leases, put in working capital, hire employees. And growth costs money. What matters is, do you get a good return on the money you're spending? And I think it's unquestionable to us that people like Larry Page and Jeff Bezos are not just great managers, they're not just great inventors, they also have been great capital allocators. And so we think they'll get a good return on the money they're reinvesting.
So you're going to stay with them. I mean, you're long-term investors. As you've always said, you invest in companies, in businesses. You don't invest in stocks. So those two, by your metrics, are still really good businesses
to own.
Well,
they're two of our largest positions.
Right, right.
But I would say there is a price at which we would trim. And, I think that, they, as more and more people come to love them, they become, today's disruptors sort of become the blue chips of tomorrow.
Is blue chip a dirty word? does it mean if so many people love them that therefore, because that is one of the wonderful themes that you have, is to today's disruptors are the blue chips of tomorrow, and you want to identify those disruptors that will become the blue chips.
Well, the blue chip, in the sense, if we think of a blue chip as meaning there's a full recognition of the durability of that
right.
business, that is a business that is going to be around, not a flash in the pan, but for years and maybe decades to come, then I think I like the term blue chip. If it comes to mean investors think there's no risk or there's no price too high, it becomes like the Nifty 50, then it becomes a dangerous time. And we are wonderful companies that we love that we've been forced to sell because of price appreciation. They just get ahead of our valuation metrics, and then we have to trim them. We would almost rather, like Berkshire, that they stay in a range of being reasonably valued, and all our return would come from the growth in value of the underlying business, that rather than having the valuation expand. So we prefer to get the growth of the underlying banks, for example, rather than have the PE go up to 20. I think they're more, there's nothing wrong with having the business fairly valued and the return coming from the earnings growth of the underlying assets.
Can you name one or two current disruptors that you've identified that you think will become blue chips eventually?
Well, I mean, certainly Amazon and Google. Mm-hmm. I mean, without question. I don't think that's quite as innovative a concept as it might have been 5 or 6 years ago. In fact, we first bought Amazon in the early 2000s. This is the third time we've owned Amazon. Each time we've owned it in the past, we've doubled or even tripled our money. And that sounds like we are very smart. But obviously we made a terrible mistake, which is each time we sold it.
Yes.
And so this is our third time owning it, again, using the same discipline. And we would like to own it for a long period of time, but we recognize it's possible that it will get so overvalued we would have to sell it. I think Walmart is about 3 times Amazon's size in terms of sales. Amazon is unquestionably a better model, an easier model to manage, a more global model. So it can have a lot of runway to go. Value investors sometimes are too focused on the past. Growth investors sometimes are only focused on the hopes and dreams of the future and not enough on the economics of the underlying business today. Trying to marry those two, I think that's what gets you through decades.
Marrying those two, therefore, if there's one investment that we should all own in a long-term diversified portfolio, what would you recommend?
Well, of course, I always say my portfolio because it's a portfolio. But, I always, in this case, recommend Berkshire. I think that, we have a family foundation, mm-hmm. and that money is invested in our funds or in the same style as our funds.
Yes.
It's a separate account, but managed in exactly the same stocks in the same way. With the exception that we have an excess position in Berkshire, which we think is all right, because in some ways it's a non-correlated investment. I think for an investor who said, I'm going to own one stock, or I'm only going to own a handful of stocks, owning Berkshire is almost like owning a super index. It's in some ways it's concentrated, but it's diversified across different businesses, across different geographies, even across different asset classes. If you look in their history, they've owned commodities, they've owned private equity, public equity, and here it is trading at a very, very reasonable value. So I'd recommend Berkshire.
Chris Davis, lovely to have you here on Wealth Track. Congratulations on your 25th anniversary of the financial fund as
Thank
well.
Thank you so much, Consuelo.
At the close of every Wealth Track, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point, take advantage of the power of compounding in stocks. Whether you decide to invest with an active manager you trust or in a single company like Berkshire Hathaway that also makes the investment decisions for you, or invest in an S&P 500 index fund, which Warren Buffett again recommended at his annual meeting, or a combination of all of the above, if you stay invested in carefully selected portfolios, the returns will compound. As Buffett told shareholders, all the commercial push is behind telling you that you ought to think about doing something today that's different than you did yesterday. You don't have to do that. You just have to sit back and let American industry do its job for you. Amen. Next week, do you own any international real estate? Five-star fund manager Greg Fisher will tell you why you might want to have a slice in your portfolio. To hear more of our interview with Chris Davis about the Davis Family Investment Approach, go to our website's extra feature. Also, continue to reach out to us on Facebook and Twitter. Thank you for joining us. Have a super weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sayles, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Thornburg Investment Management, active management, global perspective. Rosalind P. Walter and the Fairholme Foundation.